The following presentation was recorded at the 2016 SouthEast LinuxFest in Charlotte, North Carolina. It is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For more information about the SouthEast LinuxFest, please visit www.southeastlinuxfest.org. The SouthEast LinuxFest would like to thank the following diamond sponsors in 2016 for helping make these videos possible.
Oh, I'm on. All right. I'll wait for this fine gentleman to pop out. And he has popped. Okay. Hello. You're here, I hope, for cutting some slack, decoding IRC. If you're not, then I shan't take offense to you standing up and leaving now, or at any other point during the conversation. You need to tweet at me. I need to turn on my clicker. That works so much better. Oh, look at that. If you need to tweet at me, it's right here. Technology, how does it work? Anyway, if you need to tweet at me there, it's also on every slide. Let's get this ball rolling. With a quick introduction, I am VM Brasseur, but because we're all friends here, you can just call me Vicky. Please no virtual machine jokes, they've gotten old. If you wish to contact me at any time, my Twitter, at VM Brasseur. VM Brasseur is my IRC nick, and if you want to email me for any reason, suff2016@vmbrasseur.com. I'm a senior software engineering manager. I work at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. I work in service to a team which is 100% dedicated to upstream open source development, primarily on OpenStack, but we also have people on Python Core and JavaScript Core. I want to take a moment to thank Hewlett-Packard Enterprise for allowing me to be here today. They do legitimately love open source, which is why they love it when I come out and help people. So thank you, HPE. So we're going to do something which right now we call in management setting up expectations, which is what we are going to cover in this. The results of this talk are primarily driven from a survey which I conducted. Over 200 people responded, telling me what sort of things they think a new IRC user should know. And so I use that to inform the contents of this talk. They thought, you need to know what even is IRC. The fundamental building blocks and our concepts which underlie IRC, and without which you can't really understand anything else. Some IRC commands, naturally, which might not be natural if you've never seen IRC, to be honest. And etiquette, how to behave on IRC. And then there will be a really quick wrap-up at the end. What I will not cover, because A, we don't have time, but also B, we don't have time, is logging. How do you log? How do you keep scroll back for IRC? I won't be covering that in this talk. That is a more advanced topic, but really not that advanced. Then we have persistence. How do I stay online at IRC all the time? Bots? Don't cover bots. Nope, someone else can cover bots. I think his name is Chris Prather and he's sitting right over there. And customizations for IRC, particularly for your client. I'm not going to cover that as well. So there will be a lot of commands that I throw out here, a lot of things you can put at your command line in your client. You don't have to go scrolling them down. You don't have to go snapping photos, except for this one. Because the slides for this are already available online at Internet Archive. When this video becomes available, I shall download it and then put it also in this place at Internet Archive, one-stop shopping. Also here are additional resources, such as the IRC Quick Start Guide, which is at opensource.com. That is linked here as well. So there's lots of really great information linked here on this Internet Archive page. Excuse me. I will show this URL again at the end of the session, so don't worry if you don't get it right now, you can get it later. Also, one final thing before I get into the meat of the talk, please save your questions until the end. I'm very easily distracted. Alright, so with that, let's get started. With what even is IRC? How many of you here have used IRC before? Okay, really the easier way to do this, who here has not yet used IRC? Excellent. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I value your feedback greatly at the end of this talk. I mean, everybody's, but theirs in particular, because y'all already know what I'm talking about. And quite frankly, I'm confused that you're here. So what even is IRC? IRC stands for Internet Relay Chat. It is one of the earliest real-time chat systems on the internet. This is Jarko Orkarinen. I apologize, Jarko, for mispronouncing your name. Doesn't he look like a lovely fellow? I think he's lovely. He just looks like such good fun. So Jarko invented IRC. He was a student at a university in Finland. And he said, well, for my university, I'm going to duplicate all of these various things that PBS does. And we're going to use it across our university internet system. And it'll be marvelous. And the first thing he did was person-to-person chat, real-time chat. And that took off so well, and it seemed to be so valuable, that he dropped his plans to do the rest of the PBS and just focus his efforts on IRC. He did this in 1987. Keep in mind, Tim Berners-Lee invented the web in 1988. So IRC has been around a lot longer even than the web. Well, a little bit longer anyway. He did the right thing, as we all believe. He made it freely available. Surprisingly, to no one, it took off. Often it took off on floppy disks, which were handed from person to person. So we have Jarko to thank for this, and I'm very grateful, because I love IRC and I spend all my time on it. So IRC itself, it hit its peak around 2004 or 5, and it had millions and millions of users at that time. Large reason for its popularity was that it was picked up by gamers. QuakeNet is still one of the largest IRC networks out there. Since then, most of IRC has been on the wane, and on the wane I mean a huge crash. Not a lot of people are using it as much, even gamers, although it is still quite popular. The Freenode IRC network, on the other hand, this is a graph of their membership and their channel. They are the exception to the rule. They have been growing almost consistently throughout their entire life cycle. At a max, they were just under 100,000 people. Now they're about 80,000 and seem to be holding relatively steady. So that's 80,000 unique users. But that's 50,000 unique channels. So there's a lot of activity happening on Freenode IRC every single day. So if you've been around since 1987, in your venerable, venerable piece of internet history, you don't get that old without people getting a bit of a reputation around you. So there are some criticisms about IRC, and you see these bandied about all the time, particularly by kids today, get off my lawn. Such as arcane, it is arcane and opaque to learn. It's just hard to learn IRC. I'm going to stamp a little person's foot. Oof, and shake the cookie. It is not logged by default. You don't get full scrollback, full searchable scrollback in IRC unless you do some, you know, folder roll. You don't have a persistent presence by default. This means somebody can message you and you won't see it because you're not online. But primarily people complain because it's not shiny. And it doesn't have quite as many animated GIFs and emojis, and they don't like them. So there is a reason why Freenode, why IRC is still used today. There's many reasons. These are the ones that I think we really need to focus on, particularly as free and open source advocates. Number one, it is ubiquitous and open to anyone with an internet connection. If you have a device from 1987 or later, and maybe even earlier because hobbyists rock, you can use IRC. There's undoubtedly an IRC client for it. It is incredibly lightweight, very, very low bandwidth requirements, unless you have a big, ugly, nasty IRC client. But as part of the appeal of IRC is that it is not very heavy. Clients aren't either. It is loggable. You have to do some stuff to do it, but it is very loggable. And the logs are nice and small and easy to search, and you get to do whatever you want with them because they're yours. It is also scriptable. People have done the most astonishing things on IRC using bots and other scripts. It is discoverable. Anyone can go to any open IRC network and join. All they have to do is find the network. They don't have to sign up for a special account. They don't have to wait for somebody to approve them. They can find out every single open channel on that particular network. very easily without asking somebody's permission. There is no gatekeeper for IRC. And it is free in all senses of the word. IRCD, which is one of the pieces of software, the daemon which runs IRC, is licensed under the GPL. You can use it however you want. You can distribute it however you want. It's just free. It's, of course, if you run your own server, you do have to pay the server costs, but as we all know, those have been dropping like a rock in the past 10, 20 years, so that doesn't even cost so much. Practically free to run. And of course, the biggest, most important reason for us to care about IRC is that it is still the most popular real-time chat option for free and open source software projects. If you're planning to use or participate in any free or open source software project, odds are pretty good you will need to learn at least a little bit of IRC. So, I love IRC. I spend 24 hours a day on IRC. I think it's wonderful. So, just get that out there right now. I am a big fan. But, I'm not a sycophant, and I'll tell you that there is an elephant in the room. That elephant is that some of those criticisms are correct. Particularly the one that IRC is not overly easy for people to learn. It is arcane. You have to go to special places to learn it, and it's not well documented. There's plenty of articles about IRC, but they're all written from the point of view of somebody who is already a very skilled engineer. They're not written for new contributors. They're not written for the new people who have never seen this sort of thing before. They're not written for the people who are used to Slack and HipChat. And so therefore, it does appear to be arcane. And that's okay, because this is such a solvable problem. And I'm starting here today, solving that now, with this talk. So, let's get into some of the foundations of IRC. What are the underlying concepts of IRC which you will need in order to continue moving forward? Really, it's quite simple. It's surprisingly simple, and it ought to be laid out for everyone. You need a network. And by this, I mean an IRC network that somebody has set up for you, most likely. You need a client to connect to that network, just like you need a client to connect to your email. You're not reading it directly off SMTP, are you? You need a nickname. Pick one. It's you. You need a channel on which to speak, but really this is optional because you can have one-to-one conversation without a channel on IRC. And obviously you need an internet connection. This doesn't work so well with passenger pigeon. So I'm going to break these down a little bit and give a bit more information so as to demystify some of the foundations of IRC. We'll start with the network. And it will surprise nobody in this room that a network is a collection of servers. Because that's what networks are, at least as far from an IT perspective. So when you connect to, say, Freenode, you don't connect to a single server. You connect to Freenode, the network. IRC does the right thing and figures out what is the appropriate server for you in particular to be logged onto. And then you can speak with everyone else in the network, even though you are logged into a particular server. But you do log into the network itself. There are a number of popular free and open source software related IRC networks out there. You have the Open and Free Technology Community, OFTC. OFTC, if you go there, you can find channels about Debian, Tor, Ceph, GCC, and a number of other very important projects to open source. Mozilla, they run their own IRC network. All of the Mozilla projects, you can find channels and discuss on the Mozilla network. You also find a lot of Rust there. So if you're into the new hotness, the flavor of the week, Rust, you can find a lot of information there. IRC.pearl.org. We run our own IRC network. Chris runs it. And so you can go here for all Pearl projects. There are also some non-Pearl projects there. Not a lot of them, but there are. And then there's the Big Daddy, which I keep mentioning, which is Freenode. And so many different projects can be found on Freenode. The ones I am in most particular interested in are the OpenStack projects. because that is where my team devotes most of its energy. But there are so many other projects there. Like I said, there are 50,000 channels on Freenode. So that's an overview of networks. And from an open source perspective, the networks you're most likely most interested in. Very easy to find these online. Then there are clients, the things with which you use to connect to the network. So I mentioned, there are a lot of different options, as you can probably imagine. IRC has been around since 1987, for crying out loud. People have been making IRC clients since then. It's kind of like to-do apps, you know, everyone wants their own to-do app because no to-do app ever does it just the way they want. Same thing with IRC clients. So people keep making IRC clients. There's a lot of them. It is a very, very personal choice. I encourage you to, if you are going to dive into IRC, try multiple clients and see which one fits you best. Don't let anyone tell you that this is the only way to do it. You should only use this client. You should only use that. No, it's a personal choice, like your Emacs setup, for instance, is a personal choice. Very important. You get what's right for you. On Windows, according to the survey I did, the most popular IRC client is MIRC. Almost 100% of the Windows users who responded to the survey used MIRC. On Linux, it's IRC, and that is how you pronounce that, IRC or WeChat. And almost all of the people who use these use it running on a separate server and then a screen session and blah, blah, blah. So it gets a little complicated on Linux, but you can run it just on your Linux desktop. You can run either of these and it's perfectly fine. And then on OS X, Mac, it's textual. Most people use textual. There are others. There's LimeChat, for instance, was the runner-up in OS X. So this is a very personal choice. And I'll tell you that I don't use any of these. My particular IRC client of choice is IRC Cloud. Here's where you can find their URL. It is an online service for IRC. It is an online IRC client. It runs on the web by default, although I should point out that almost every, I think every single one of the networks I mentioned already has a web interface for it. So you can go to their websites and get a web interface and you can use it via your Firefox or your Chrome or what have you. But IRC Cloud is web, Android, iOS, all desktops via an Electron app. And it hands off communication between all of them seamlessly. And this is invaluable for somebody like me whose job relies upon IRC. I can have a conversation here, step out to take a meeting, and have a conversation, continue the conversation on my phone without missing a single thing. Bloody brilliant. Another thing IRC Cloud gets you is scroll back. By default, you don't have to do any of the folder roll that you have to do with other IRC in order to get that persistent scroll back. You get persistence as well. I'm online literally 24/7, all the time. Even when I'm sleeping, I will wake up and check all my messages that have come in from my team members around the globe. It also has integration with other services like GitHub, GIST, Pastebin, Twitter, YouTube. It does a really great job of integrating with other services. I believe it is the perfect option for new IRC users, but you can probably guess I'm not a new IRC user, and I use this. A lot of our team, who have been around for a very long time, they use this because it's just so easy and mindless. It's perfect. And let me just tell you, I am not getting a kickback here. I think it is the right option for new users because it makes it so easy. So that's some talk about client. Let's talk about nicknames. In IRC speak, it's not your nickname, it's not your handle, it's your nick. That's what I will be using terminology throughout the rest of this talk. This is your IRC identity. How many of you use Twitter? Okay, your Twitter handle, that's how everybody knows you. You go to conferences and they expect to see your Twitter handle in great big letters, or at least I do, and I do a ton of conferences. They're like, oh yeah, you're being Brasseur. That's your nick. That is who you are on IRC. You don't have a physical presence, all you have is your nick. So this can be really anything you want, as long as somebody else hasn't used it. Any valid characters are those. Officially, according to the IRC RFC, of which you know there is one, there is a maximum of 9 characters for your IRC nick, but that's not really the case. Most networks support considerably more. Freenode, for instance, supports up to 16 for your IRC nick. But it can be anything you want. So nicknames, they're pretty obvious. We all know how to do this by now. We've all been around the internet for maybe half of our lives, some of us, all of our lives. We have channels. Again, a concept which isn't going to be too radical. This is just a chat room. Everybody outside of the room can't hear what's going on. Everyone inside of the room can participate in the conversation. Channel names, by convention on IRC, typically start with either a single hash or a double hash. There is a difference between these, but only conventionally. It is not enforced in any way, aside from convention and culture and mores. So a single hash is for an official channel. So for instance, let's say you wish to work on the OpenStack project. You would go to hash OpenStack-dev. That is an official channel. You will only discuss OpenStack dev things on that channel. Hash hash, a double hash, is for more casual channels. So you can go to hash hash OpenStack-social. And there you can hang out with your friends. And got somebody there right now who keeps posting really great cocktail recipes. And you know, that's where you have more of the social casual aspect. And people aren't really talking about OpenStack business in that. But that's because it's a hash hash rather than a hash. So that's the convention for channel names. Channels can be hidden, they can be private, they can be invite only. It is possible to set the modes for these. But typically, channels are open to everyone. When you create a channel by default, it is open to everyone. So some examples of channels on Freenode. You have opensource.com, hash opensource.com. Please come hang out with us there. We're lovely people. Hash Conservancy is the channel for the Software Freedom Conservancy. And one I threw together this morning, hash hash SE LinuxFest. Feel free, if you've got an IRC open, join that, start a conversation around this particular conference. Very casual, just, you know, back chat. So these are all the real fundamental, that's really all you need to know. These are the foundations of IRC, upon which everything else is built conceptually. But how do you do anything, right? How do you actually get shit done on IRC? Well, you use commands. And generally speaking, there are a lot of commands, but generally speaking, commands will start with a slash. If you see a slash, it's an IRC command. You're going to see a lot of those in the following slides. But again, remember, these slides are already available on Internet Archive, so you can just, you don't have to take photos or scroll down these commands. Some commands accept or require at least one argument. Some do not. And the commands which follow, I'll tell you which are which. So we're going to start by assuming you have connected to an IRC network. It's pretty easy for most clients. Most of them will have drop-downs for the most popular networks, and so you just go, bam, and done. You're connected. You have a nickname. You should register your name. You don't have to register your name on IRC. But if you don't, you have laid no claim to it, which means someone else is free to come along later and take it from you. And that's fine, because it's IRC. If you didn't claim it, if you didn't lick that cookie, someone else is going to eat it. So register your nick. This will help reduce confusion as you're having conversations with people. If you go away, you leave IRC, if you come back and somebody else is taking your nick, they could impersonate you. So, you know, just register. You do this by talking to NickServe, which is the nickname management service that runs on pretty much all IRC networks. And here's how you do that. Now, you have to be using the nickname you want to register in order for this to work. And all you do is you type slash message, which again, because of the slash, you know it's a command. then you're sending a private message, that's what that means, to Mixer, which is the service, sending it the keyword register so it knows what to do, the password under which you wish to, with which you wish to register that nickname, and then your email address. Now, your email address is not going to be used very much at all, and is pretty much just a fallback position. In case you aren't smart enough yet to have, say, started using a password manager, like 1Password, you might not remember your password. If that happens, then the admins of the IRC network can use your email address to get in touch with you and help you recover your account. So that's how you register it. I do highly recommend you do that. Again, not required, but strongly recommended. But once you've registered it, you still have to identify. In IRC terms, it's not login, it's identify, because you haven't actually logged in. All you do is connect. That's all you have to do. You connect, you identify yourself after registering your nick. Super easy to do. Again, Mixer, as you can imagine, comes in on this. And you again send just a private message to Mixer. You send it the keyword identify, so again, it knows what you're doing, and you give it the nick that you're identifying, and then the password associated with that nick. That's it. Basic login, except it's command line stuff rather than some sort of JavaScript pop-up. So you have registered your nick, you've identified with your nick. As far as the IRC network is concerned right now, this is your nick. But it doesn't have to be. You can pretend to be someone else, or you can use a different name. You register one name and then use another. And it's very easy. It is mindlessly easy to change your name. There can be many reasons for doing this. They are varied. But you can change it at any time. When you change your nick, let's say you're playing a joke on a friend in one channel, and you change your nick to OMG Chris Squeak. I'm going to keep picking on Chris over here, by the way. Hi, Chris. I do this precisely to embarrass you because you're lovely. And I know he won't beat me afterwards. So, OMG Chris Squeak. I changed my name to OMG Chris Squeak in a channel we're in. I don't know if you remember, but I use IRC for work. That takes effect network-wide, not just on one channel. So all of the channels I'm in for OpenStack, all of the channels I'm in for the team, all of the other channels I'm in, I am now seen as OMG Chris Squee on all of them. So be careful when changing your nick. That warning sign, here's how you do it. Command slash nick, and then whatever you want to be called. So for me, it would be slash nick, OMG Chris Squee. When I get tired of that, or I realize that, holy crap, I was in the middle of a meeting over in #OpenStack-meetings, now everybody has to call me OMG Chris Squeak. That's embarrassing. I'll switch back to my old one, which is just the same thing again. Slash nick, and then VM Brasseur, which is my IRC nick on Freenode and irc.com.org. All right, so you've got a name, and you're using a name, and it might even be the name you registered. But you're not here to pick a name. You're here to talk to people. In order to talk to people, it probably helps to be in the channel. So how do you do that? Just join the channel name. Now, remember I told you channels primarily start with either a hash or a hash hash. Please consider that part of the channel name. It's not just a little signifier, which will be confusing because for people there are signifiers before their names, which you should not use. But for channels, definitely use that hash. Use that hash hash. It is part of the channel name. So you slash join #opensource.com. That is what you would type. So let's say I accidentally type /join #opensource.coo. Say I fat-fingered that. IRC, rather than going, OMG, cannot join, cannot find channel, it's just going to politely create one for me. So that's how you create a new channel. Just slash join anything that doesn't exist. So that is how I actually created the #SELinuxFest. I knew it didn't exist. Part of this, I was pretty sure it didn't exist because it was a hash hash. And so I just slash join #SELinuxFest. Bam, it exists as of, you know, 30 minutes ago, I was the only person in there. Hopefully there are a few more of you now. Please tell your friends, tweet it out. Right there. So you've joined the channel, you've had your little conversations, you've gotten your questions answered, you've answered other people's questions because this is what we do in open source. And now it's time to leave. Really, that's all you need to do. / leave channel name. And again, you need the hash or the hash because that is part of the channel name. Then you leave the channel. If you're already on the channel, you can just type / leave. And then you're gone. Some IRC clients will keep that channel listed in your list of channels that you're in, just in an inactive state. But others won't. Others will completely remove it. This is just an implementation detail. You're no longer in the channel. Don't worry. So you're in a channel, but again, who cares? That's not what you're here. Otherwise, you could join 50,000 channels on Freenode and go, ooh, I have one IRC. I'm joining all the channels. That's not what you're there for. You want to actually talk to people. And how do you do that? Probably not going to surprise you all that all you do is just type. Type anything. As long as it's not a command, and then hit enter. And then you're talking to people. That's it. Really easy. You can also use this / say command, however. This isn't used very often, almost never, but here's a situation where you might want to. Let's say you want to start a statement. Let's say I'm talking to Ricky, and Ricky's asking, hey, how do I change my nick again? I want to say / nick is the command for changing your nickname, but if I just say that, then it's going to interpret / nick as a command. But if I do / say / nick, then what will come out is / nick is the command for changing your nickname. So that's really the only reason I've ever seen to use say. But if you need it, it's there. So you can say things, but you can also do things on IRC, in as much as you're in a virtual space rather than meet space. So you can take actions during conversation, and you do that by the me command, / me. This is a command I can send, / me waves to the audience. And what that looks like, you snuck in. So what that looks like, an IRC is VM Brasseur waves to the audience. What / me essentially does is it replaces itself with your nickname, and then places whatever action after your nickname. So it looks like you are taking an action. You become third person. So now you're chatting, you're dancing, you're taking actions, you're doing all sorts of things on IRC. Once in a while, you need to just have a one-on-one with somebody. OMG, Ricky, I'm going to be really late with that article. I'm so sorry. Can I talk to you about it? I can send her a private message. It's just a one-on-one conversation. It is private. No one else can see what is happening. But remember, IRC can be logged. So anything you say in any channel can be logged by anyone in any of those channels, including yourself. But this counts as well for private messages. Full disclosure, I log everything. So if you ever write me, now you know. It is best practice to ask someone in channel whether you may PM them. Otherwise, you just out of the blue start pinging them with PMs, and you're creepy. It really looks kind of stalkery sometimes. And it can be a pain in the butt if somebody's in the middle of something. I'm sorry, I don't have time for a PM right now. So just please ask. Just in channel say, hey, is it okay if I PM you? And typically, unless you're a flaming jerk on wheels, they will say yes. Or unless they've got something going on in their life that they're just not able to talk to somebody right now. But ask first. So the way you do that, you start the conversation with / MSG, and then their nickname. So for Chris, I would do / MSG Peregrine, and then we would start a private conversation, a PM, and this would show up in my particular list, in my client, kind of like another channel. Officially on IRC in the documentation, you will see this rather than a private message, referred to as a query. And I can get into more detail about why that is, but if you read more documentation, you might see reference to queries. This counts as a query. but it will show up as kind of a channel. And then you can just type back and forth, and you can do your stays, and you can do your meets, and you can do all the stuff you normally would in a channel, just one-on-one. So let's say all of you beautiful people join the appropriate channels, either, let's say, #opensource.com, and I want to know more about you. I can use the /who and the /whois command to return more information about you. But you see, the thing is, this is IRC. And it is limited to the information which you want to share. It's not like I can get tons of information. I might be able to get your real name if you choose to share it. I might be able to get your IP address, which we all know, VPNs and what have you. It's not like we should trust them as the real thing anyway. But it is limited to the information you wish to share. If you want to find out more about me on Freenode, you can do that. It will show you my real name, but you got it already. That's fine. Sometimes you have to go to sleep. It is the internet, and yet sometimes you do have to pull yourself away from cat gifts and just go to sleep. You can mark yourself away on IRC rather than logging off. And that is just with /away. Alternatively, you can give more people more information with /away and then a message. /away, ERB. /away, headed to school. /away, neighbor's house is on fire. You know, you can do whatever you want, but you don't have to. You don't have to give people that information. You can just do a /away. When you're back, when you're done putting out the neighbor's fire, you can /away again. You can also /back. I don't know if that works on all networks. It does by way of IRC Cloud. But /away again undoes away. So whatever the implementation, by the way, I'm not showing screenshots of IRC at all intentionally during this, and that's because there are so many different implementations of IRC clients. I don't want you to get attached to any particular one or think it's right. So, but all of them will have some way for you to see a list of the people in that particular channel. And some of them will have weird little symbols before their names. Their nicks, sorry. Those actually do mean something. They are not a part of the nick. They are symbols of various modes and status within that particular channel. The one you are going to see most often is an at sign. At sign is an operator. That is somebody with authority in that channel. They can kick people, they can invite people, they can do all sorts of lovely things. They have God mode in that particular channel. If there are any problems in the channel, any bad behavior, feel free to ping one of these people, and they should be able to help you. Another one you'll see considerably less often, because it's just not very useful, frankly, is a plus sign. That means somebody is voiced. Some channels can be set such that only people who have a voice are allowed to speak in them, which I find kind of rude. But if somebody is voiced, then you'll have a plus sign. People can be voiced in channels which are not limited to only voiced people. So you'll see everybody talking in a channel, and some of them will have pluses and some will not. It's just somebody screwed up some user modes and it's fine. But that's what a plus means. It's really not important. But now you know. There are some other symbols you'll see before names, but these are the ones you'll see most often. Primarily that at sign is the most important. So there's a bunch of commands. Let's tell you how not to get kick banned from IRC. Kick banned sounds exactly what it is, which is you get kicked out of the channel and then you get banned from it and you never learn that. And that's because you've been an asshole. Keep in mind, asshole is in the eye of the beholder. So every particular channel will have its own culture. Do not assume that every single culture is the same. That said, hey, they share a lot of things in common. Number one, particularly in IRC channels, it is a welcoming place full of helpful people who are volunteering their time to answer questions and to work together. You will see some people saying that IRC is a cesspool. Just like saying the entire internet is a cesspool because 4chan exists. That's not fair. There are some bad rooms and channels in IRC, but for the most part, they're very helpful people. As with any community, though, pay attention to their particular culture and mores. Each channel, again, is different. And in case of jerks, please report it. Those nice people with the little at symbol, those ops, those operators, tell them. If we tolerate assholes, it just breeds more of them. The only reason there are assholes in communities is that we allow them to stay there. We have the power to fix this. And also, IRC is a very curious beast, in as much as it's both real-time and asynchronous. For instance, I am on IRC right now. You're asking me questions there, I'm not seeing it. That's asynchronous. However, there are lots of other people there who will be able to answer your question in real time, and other times I will be real time. If you have a question and nobody immediately jumps on it, it's okay, it's cool, wait. Somebody will get to it. If in a few hours somebody hasn't, then you can say, hey, did anyone see my question up there? And you repeat the question so nobody has to scroll. But give it several hours. Also remember that IRC is global. The people in that particular channel may not be in your time zone. So please, wait, be patient, and people will get back to you. So let's talk a little bit about channel culture. Always, 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 please read the topic. Almost every single channel will have one. As you join a channel, you should be presented with the topic. If you're not, you can type /topic command and you will see the topic for that particular channel. Some topics have links in them for more information. Please always adhere to what they're saying. If you join a channel about dogs, please don't talk about hedgehogs. That's not what they're there for. If it says in the topic that they are that the channel is OpenStack meetings, please don't start talking about the OpenStack Keystone unless it's the Keystone meeting. Pay attention to the topic, otherwise people are going to get really cheesed at you. And secondly, lurk in the channel for a while. Don't just show up and blurt out your question, because that might not be the way people handle things in that channel. Just sort of hang out. Show up, listen to people, read what they say, see how they interact, rather than just diving in and assuming everybody does things the way you do. This is a huge community. It is global. Not everyone is like you. So take a minute or an hour to learn. And then you can start interacting with these people. So let's say you want to get my attention in any channel in which I am. You can mention my name. And what that will do is it will ping me. And what a ping means, again, varies by client. IRC Cloud will play a sound for me and it will pop up something on all of my devices. So if you ping me, if I'm around, I'm really going to notice it. So that's how you get somebody's attention, is you ping them. If you ping without content, this is called a naked ping. And it really, really bothers some people. It doesn't bother me a lot, but in my survey I discovered that this really bugs people a lot. So if you do ping somebody, please follow it up with, hey Michael, I read that article, that was really great, thanks for that. Rather than just, Michael.
What?
Right, exactly. You don't want to do that. So that was something that bothered people in the survey, and they wanted to make sure new users knew. Another thing that really bothered them, if you have a question, please ask. Don't ask to ask. You do not need permission. The thing about IRC is everyone has permission by default to ask questions. Do not walk into an IRC. Walk. There's your metaphors, Chris. Do not walk into an IRC channel and say, hey, I have a question about OpenStack Nova. Yeah, we all do. That's why we're here. What the hell are you talking about? Come in and say, I'm trying to get Nova running on this platform and this configuration, and I'm getting this particular core dump. Has anybody seen this before? That is an actual useful thing. But don't come in asking, saying, hey, can I ask someone here about Nova? So when you do get that core dump, please don't paste it into IRC. For love of dog, OMG, WTF, BBQ. Large text dumps are incredibly unfriendly. Some clients won't even allow you to do it. So use a paste bin, use a gist, put it in, a file on a web server somewhere and then link to it, anything, just link to it rather than dumping it in. Because otherwise people can get really annoyed with you. And justify this up because you really screw up their scroll bar. And then if you go away, it used to be that people would change their nick to say, let's say I have to be gone. I could change it to slash nick the ambassador underscore away. What I have just done has made it really difficult for people to ping me because my nick has changed. Something you should know about mentioning people. A lot of clients have implemented a tab complete. So if you're in a channel, you don't have to learn how to spell my last name. Fully for you. No, you can just type VM and then tab and it'll autocomplete. If you do that, then you will have, or if I do this, my pointer is on the pointer, staring into a laser. I'm worried. then any private messages I had under a different nick, say VM Brasseur, suddenly become disconnected. Because now I'm no longer VM Brasseur. Now, as far as IRC knows, I'm VM Brasseur away. So the people I was PMing, they can't PM me anymore. They have to go PM VM Brasseur away. It's really annoying. Don't do that. Just use slash away. All right. So you're talking to all these people. Before I get going on writing style, I want to do a quick mention of, again, this is a global community. Not everybody there speaks your language, whatever that language is. So, while there are guidelines here for how to write and how to communicate, please don't be draconian about them when somebody else comes in and has really poor grammar or can't spell, because we're not all native speakers. So first of all, okay, here's the one where I expect almost every single hand to go up. Who uses Slack and or HipChat? Oh, considerably fewer than I expected. I'm not used to that in a room like this. So in Slack and or HipChat, in order to get somebody's attention, in order to mention them, you put an at in front of their name. On IRC, even if they are an op, even if they are an operator and they have an at in front of their name, please don't use it. Some IRC people can get really, really defensive because they're sick of being compared to Slack. And if you put an at in front of somebody's name, they will jump all over your ass. E, not Slack. So try not to do that. Character limits are not a practical concern on IRC. Type the sentence you need, hit enter, use full language. Type things out. Don't type for you if it is F-O-R space Y-O-U. There's no need for that. Just type it out. All caps is shouting. It is everywhere on the internet. It is not different on IRC. If you actually need to shout at someone, feel free. Knock yourself out. But don't use it all the time. And IRC supports ANSI color. So I am a program. I believe there's more than one way to do it. But just because there is, and you can do something some way, doesn't mean you should. Just because IRC can do colors does not mean you should. So please don't. A lot of clients, by the way, will strip this out. So even if you set colors, people aren't going to see it. So really, this is all you need to get started and look like a pro on IRC. IRC is huge, it's big, it's massive, there's a lot of options there that you just don't have to care about. So that's really all you need. You can get going. So to wrap up, I have some gratitude. I did do that survey. There were over 200 people who responded. These are the ones who agreed to share their information for me to thank them publicly. Some of them are Twitter handles, some of them are IRC names. All of them are wonderful. Thank you, people, for helping with this. I'm very grateful. There were some images in this talk. Most of them come from a marvelous thing called the Noun Project, where you can get Creative Commons art and support the artists. So these tiny little icons, and including the elephant, which you saw earlier, are from the Noun Project. The picture of Yargo comes from this Swedish newspaper. And the free note stats comes from irc.net, split.de, which is a brilliant bloody place if you want to learn a lot more about IRC than you ever thought existed. A colophon mostly in here for the PDF that nobody cares about, but Markdown, deck set, Mac theme, yeah. I really like this software a lot, so if you use Mac, feel free to come ask me and I will squeal like a little girl and tell you all about it. And finally, the resources. Here's that URL again. This has links to additional resources, including a quick start guide for IRC, which was published on opensource.com this morning, an article on IRC on IRC and the fundamentals of IRC, which was published on opensource.com this morning, these slides, and most importantly to me personally is an evaluation link. I give my talks all the bloody time. I think I'm doing 16 conferences this year. And I really value feedback. So if you could rate the talk, tell me how I did, and give me any sort of feedback you have, it will get integrated into the talk the next time I do this. So this is iterative talk development. You're going to give me feedback and help me make things better, and I'm very, very grateful for it. Do the thing, the eval thing, join the eval empire. And that is my very last slide, and it looks like we have 10 minutes left for questions. If anybody has any questions about IRC or anything like that, I'm here. Or please try to hold off on comments. Conceal this question. Let's try and keep it to questions over here. Yes, dear, what's your name?
Jeremy.
Hi, Jeremy. Nice to meet you.
Same. Thank you. This is a real new question, but how do you discover channels?
I was going to put that in here, but it got too complicated. And, oh, crap, hardware. How does it work? So to discover channels, it can be quite complicated in really large networks because often your client won't be able to return all, say, 50,000 entries. But it's just slash list. That's it, slash list. And on certain clients, depending upon how your client has implemented it, you can then filter that. On textual, on Mac, it will pop it up in a separate window with a cute little search box, which is wicked handy. Can't do that on IRC Cloud. You do have to find other ways to do it on the IRC Cloud. But if you go to irc.netsplit.de, it has pages for each IRC network. I don't know how frequently they're updated, but that lists every single bloody channel on them. So you can also do that if it's not a wicked new channel that you just created yourself. Very good question. I'm sorry, I don't know if I repeated that for the audio, but Jeremy asked, how do you discover channels? You had a question, yes. What's your name?
I'm Scott.
Hi, Scott.
Hi. So my question is, do you have to be registered on a network to use slash away?
The question is, do you have to be registered on a network to use slash away? And the answer is no. You do not have to be registered on a network to use slash away. By the way, Chris, I'm going to use you as my fact checker if I stick my foot in my mouth at any point. Okay. Feel free to, chuck something at me or no, you do not have to be registered. There are very few things for which you do have to be registered, but there are some, such as if you are on an invite-only channel. I'm on a few invite-only channels. If I am not registered and identified, I won't be able to get into those channels. So there are practical reasons to be registered, but slash away is not one of them. Chris, have a yes?
Well, so NIP registration and that stuff is dependent upon this IRC network that has to be configured for all of that. There are some older IRC networks that do not have services for NIP registration and stuff set up, in which case you don't have to register to do anything because they don't have it. But by and large, all of the networks that you mentioned, I know have services and have that stuff now.
Yeah. So Chris's point for the audio is that there are older IRC networks where they haven't configured NICSERV, they haven't configured ChanServ, which we did not discuss, but which is another, it's a channel service, clever name, ChanServ. You never guess what it is. But you do have to configure those on a network basis. So there are older networks that don't have them. All the ones I listed here that are very popular with open source and free software projects, they do have NICSERV, they do have ChanServ. Deb, yes?
I have a question about the Kickman. So you showed how easy it is to set up new NICs. Like, what if you're like jerk number one and then you get kicked out and then you're like, all right, right, cool, I'm going to re-register with your number two, and so on.
So the question is kick bans and nick changes. If you get kick banned, which again, you are kicked and you're not allowed back on that channel, you are banned, kick banned. If you come back with a different nick, what happens? There are ways to handle this, as you can probably imagine. Ban is not just on a nick basis, but it also can be on an IP basis. It can be on a mask basis. I mean, there's lots of different ways where you can try and keep the evildoers out of your channel. And it's complicated and will require you read some very opaque and arcane documentation. Is there a quick clarification, Chris?
Yeah, the easiest solution if you're in a situation like that, every IRC network has network administrators. They have the power, I'm a network administrator of IRC.pro.org, this is why I know. They have the power to ban somebody from the entire network from even logging onto the network. So most networks have a policy that if they do what's called ban evasion, they change the nick, they rejoin, that's it, you're not allowed on the network anymore because the new IRC administrator wants to have to deal with that. So they just ban you from the network.
So if there's, wait, hold on, let me get that for the audio. Chris, who is an IRC admin, a network admin, wanted to point out that if this does happen, it's called ban evasion, where somebody changes their nick so they can get back on your channel. That's ban evasion. Most IRC networks have a policy that this is very bad mojo, and you are a very bad person and should feel very bad. And in order to help you feel very bad, they have mechanisms for banning you from the entire network, not just single channels, but you have to contact an admin for that. You had another clarification? Just as long as it's very quick, because I don't want to get into conversation.
I think you already answered.
He asked if it was IP, if the server-wide ban was IP-based, and it's usually IP-based.
Yeah, the server-wide ban is IP-based. So do we have another question? We have 4 more minutes. Yes, sir, what's your name?
Actually, I have a couple of questions, but if you can only address one, that's fine.
I'll address one, go to someone else.
Sure.
We have time, we'll get back to you.
My question is more around IRC Cloud. Does it support notifications for channel notices if you / notice a channel?
So the question is about IRC Cloud and whether it supports notifications for channels for / notice a channel. I don't use / notice, I don't know what that does. I do know I get tons of notices on channels. Yes, it does. You can turn off notifications, turn them on and off for specific channels. Yeah, there are some channels I have off completely because I don't need that kind of noise in my life and I just need to check in from time to time. Yeah, IRC Cloud does do that. It is really marvelous, but it is a $5 a month service for multiples, if you want to connect to multiple networks. It is, however, at least for me, $5 a month that is tax deductible because I work in open source software. And I require this to get my job done. But it's brilliant, and it's totally, I fully believe in paying for the services and the software that you use and upon which you rely. And IRC is one of them I'm very happy to pay money for every year. Gentleman back here had a question? Yes. What was your name?
Hello, I'm JD.
Hi, JD.
Hello. So one of my big troubles I have, I don't know if it's out of scope, but I find that whenever I am, say, on a laptop and I'm changing a network connection or something like that, I tend to have issues with trying to connect to an IRC server and not being able to connect because I have sort of two versions of my NIC, one with an underbar in front of it. And I didn't know whether that was my client or me making mistakes or there was some strategy for avoiding that.
So the question is disconnecting or switching to another device or shutting your laptop and coming back, and suddenly there's two of you, and then you have to try and figure out which is which, and it just gets complicated. Why does this happen and how? What are strategies around it? Primary strategy is to get a bouncer, which I am not going to cover. And a bouncer essentially is a service that runs on a completely separate machine. And you connect to it, and it is the thing connected to IRC, and it stays connected all the time. So that is also how you happen to get the scroll back. That is also how you get persistence, is to get a bouncer. I have a bouncer. Once you get it set up, it's fine. It just works. It's still a royal pain in the ass, and I don't do system administration anymore. I use IRC Cloud. It does all that for me. Was there another question? Otherwise, I will get back to you. I'm sorry, did I ever get your name here?
No, my name's Rob.
Hi, Rob. Yes, one more question from Rob, and then there was another gentleman right here. And then I think we're done with Todd.
My question, you had the word Slack in the topic of this talk, but mm-hmm. you didn't address Slack specifically. Do you see a trend of especially for development groups, moving away from IRC to Slack?
So the question is about Slack and whether there's a trend of development groups moving away from IRC to Slack. I don't have enough information to answer that. I'm the focus of this. To be honest, I put cutting some Slack, deconstructing IRC or whatever it's called in it because it's inflammatory and it gets people in the door. That's why that's titled that. Full disclosure. It's a little piece of showmanship. But the actual target for this is how to help contribute to open source projects. There are open source projects and open communities now, that's my bias showing through, for which you need to use Slack. And that's their prerogative and more power to them. But in order to use Slack, you can't just show up and walk in the door and start participating like you can with IRC. You have to ask for an account. You have to be vetted. You have to go through their little, you know, velvet rope system in order to become a part of their community, and it's not very open and welcoming. It's, from my point of view, your mileage may vary. But yes, a lot of people are using it right now. Another problem with Slack, personally, is that, oh my God, it's a beast. It eats battery power like you would not bloody believe. Its bandwidth is just through the fucking roof. Why do you need to be doing that? Really, why don't you buy a shark out of Slack someday and just go, come on, you've got a lot of brilliant people working on this project. Please, you're leaving out so many people who don't have top-of-the-line MacBooks, who don't have, you know, anything more than Edge Network, who don't have, it's really exclusionary, I believe, just from its design and architecture. But otherwise, it's brilliant. It's a lot like IRC Cloud, except shinier. But IRC Cloud is better. Anyway, yes, I have really quick time for your question. What's your name, sir?
Tom.
Hi, Tom.
If you spend a lot of time on the command line, is there a option for integrating with IRC Cloud?
I do not know whether there. I think there is an IRC Cloud command line client. That's the question. Is there an IRC Cloud command line client? I do not know. I do not work there. I don't even pretend to work there on TV. So I'm not sure. I am a Mac girl. I do spend time at the command line, but most of my time, frankly, is spent on this and this and my beautiful, adorable iPad Pro, which I love with an unholy love. So that's really all the time I have questions for. If you have any more questions, please come find me up here, or guess what, again, IRC, just DM Brasseur on IRC Freenode. I'm there all the bloody time. Okay, thank you, everyone.
Oh, it's just the radio.
To name Google, we actually went through thousands of names.
The name of the company has now become its own verb in the dictionary.
Let's Google it.
You can Google it.
Work the Google on the internet machine.
Six simple letters on a plain white page.
Being able to do searches in any language about any country.
Thing, when you're putting in a question, they'd finish your question for you.
We have been working on organizing the world's information.
Our goal is to digitize all the books.
Today, Google announced Gmail. Email for everyone for free.
Google is mapping the entire world to make it more accessible to people everywhere.
Google is jumping into the mobile market.
Android was built as an open platform for everyone to use and build on.
This is Chrome. It's a faster, safer browser for the open web.
Google is unveiling what they call the knowledge graph.
We needed to understand the world the way you and I do, as objects and relationships between objects.
Today, Google's got another useful feature with Google Now.
We are providing you with answers before you've even asked for
them. One of my favorite cards is the one that shows traffic data for your commute to and from work.
Think about how far Google has evolved from the 10 blue links.
We asked ourselves, how can we assist you right when you need it?
Okay, Google, call the Walker Arts Center.
It's not just desktops, phones, and laptops anymore.
Okay, Google. 유진이한테 5분 늦는다고 문자 보내줘.
It's watches with displays, car consoles with displays.
Okay, Google, let's go to the aquarium.
How can we help you get things done in as few steps as possible?
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google.
Okay, Google, show me my photos of Lucas with the pumpkin.
But we have to remember, we have a long way to go.
This is just the tip of the iceberg.